So this means we get the land, he gets his house, and it's a win-win all around. So I recommend that we approve this.
Okay, is that agreed, councillor?
Okay, thanks, Adrian.
Okay, item 11 we have dealt with. So I'm going to now move on to the children and family services items. First one is item 12, addition arrangements for community voluntary control primary secondary schools and coordinating scheme 2015-16. Tony.
Thanks, Chair. It's much more complicated. It invites the cabinet to determine the authority to issue arrangements for community voluntary control primary secondary schools to coordinate scheme 2015-16. Just quickly on sort of a bit of the background, on an annual basis, local authorities are required to have a coordinated scheme for all schools that includes academies. This is in respect of general arrangement for admissions and in-year admissions. There are no changes this year with the scheme from last year, and the consultations held between November to January, and no responses were received. But that's what the occasion was done. That cabinet, the recommendation, Chair, is that cabinet agree the proposed admission arrangements to the community and voluntary control school to work coordinated schemes for 2015-16.
Okay, thank you, Tony. Can you agree with that, councillor?
Yeah,
thank you very much. Which takes us on to item 13, school meals and universal preschool meals for infants. Tony?
Thank you. Right. On the report, this report is in two parts, Chair. Part one is to increase the price of a paid meal in schools from £2 to £2.30 to effect from September 2014. The second part is to implement government policy for the introduction of universal preschool meals for infant aged children. I'll just take the first one, paid school meal prices. Metro provided the authority a meal service for 80 schools, nursery, primary and special, and has a turnover in excess of 4 million. Food costs are increasing, and the unit cost of a meal is currently in excess of £2.80. At a charge of £2 for each meal, there is a significant subsidy. Decision about the price of a paid meal is taken by government bodies, taking account of local authority advice. Any other authorities in the area that we looked at currently charge in excess of £2 per meal, although none charge £2.30. Can I just say, we haven't got the figures from other local authorities for this year, so we're talking about what the charge for last year, and some of them are in excess of £2. The increase recommended reflects some, but not all, inflation pressures over the period. Help the Metro trading account achieve and maintain a balanced position. The cost of meal production will be reviewed and expansion of service will provide greater economies of scale. So that's part one, Chair. The second part is on universal free meals. I think there's been a lot in the arena the last week or so about that. This is a new national policy initiative backed by legislation to provide all infant age children in schools with a free meal. The plan for this change, some additional equipment and alterations will be needed. Capital grant of £623,802 has been allocated and should be included in the capital programme. Schools will be paid £2.30 by the government for each additional meal produced. It is anticipated that Metro meal volumes will increase by 80% in September, with an ongoing grant in the full year of school of £3.5 million. The additional revenue, I think this is good news, Jeff, funding, will fund additional food production and the need for more staff in kitchens. We're talking about 80 to 100 posts in Metro kitchens. At this time, proposals have not been considered by the school's board head teacher groups, although this will happen prior to implementation. Three recommendations. But one, that the price of a paid school meal is increasing £2.30 in September of 2014 in primary schools for services that provide the Metro services, and that this increase is recommended to governing bodies, primary and special. subject to council approval, that the capital grant received when you meant universal preschool meal for infants in paying schools, totaling £623,802, is included with the capital grant for 2014-15 and is used to address the range of schemes described. Thirdly, that metro school kitchen staffing numbers are increased to take account of additional meal numbers, the cost funded by schools, and the Department for Education revenue grant based on £2.30 per additional free meal served. That's it, Chair.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, can we agree those for
me?
Yes. Yes. And that takes us on to item 14, shall 14 budget option. Tony?
That's me again. Right. I think, further to previous reports, this report makes recommendations in relation to releasing the £250,000 further funding previously committed by Cabinet to the Birkenhead Foundation Years Trust Initiative, referred to in previous projects as the Springboard Project. A little bit of background. In September 2012, Cabinet made a number of resolutions including the release of £50,000 of the Child Poverty Budget Allocation to the Springboard Project. And this was to develop a comprehensive business case for the project that at the same time, a pre-pilot phase of work would be undertaken which would involve engaging 30 families with volunteers begin to test out and develop the model. Cabinet agreed to consider the business case at a further meeting of the Cabinet, and some of the business case be satisfactory, robust and clear about the intended outcomes, and monitoring performance management arrangements, Cabinet would take a further decision as to release of a further £250,000 to support the project. Just a little bit about the Foundation Year project. The report itemizes the activity which has been delivered by the project by its autumn 2013 or was in the advanced stages of development, which includes schemes to listen to and work with pregnant young women and parents and children aged 0 to 5 years. Appendix 1 in the report presents a summary of the Foundation Year's Trust Business Plan, sets out how the project will work to test out the ideas which underpin to report the Foundation Years, how to prevent poor children becoming poor adults. The appendix specifies activities which will be delivered and the associated costs, as well as the approach to delivering services in the context of other partnership work and strategies to support and assist vulnerable young children and their families. Children's Trust will monitor project outcomes on a quarterly basis. A few recommendations. Is that Cabinet agrees to allocate the child poverty funding of £250,000 in Cabinet Reserve to the Foundation Years Trust on the basis of the business plan in Appendix 1. Further recommended that an updated report on the work of the Foundation Years Trust is presented to Cabinet in autumn 2014. That's it, Chair.
Okay, this is an excellent project, so I'm very happy to support those recommendations. Are they agreed? Thank you very much. And I think item 15 is simply the minutes from the Policy Reforms Coordinating Committee 27th of February, which is basically the call-in around those two items, the approved consults on the closure of their school and proposals for changes to school topics. The students with high needs. So we've had those minutes given to us this evening. So, what members would just know those minutes of service?
No.
Yeah, can we know those minutes?
Agreed.
Yeah. Thank you very much. I've done that. Rightio. Thanks for that, Tony. So let's move on to the adult social care items. So the first one is item 16, social enterprise development. Day services, Chris?
Thank you. Thank you, Chief. This is yet another exciting project on JAS, I have to say. This report brings forward a revised proposal to develop an alternative rural-based delivery organisation to be co-designed with key stakeholders, including staff and peer and carers. And this follows the really interesting presentation which you attended with both Cllr, and I'm absolutely delighted to see John Dolby here tonight, who gave a presentation on behalf of the Cllrs, both from himself and officers. And this has ended up as an excellent sort of compromise, really, between the two original proposals. We want to continue to work productively with service users and their Cllrs to develop a different service model, which meets and enhances the aspirations of the people who use it, and that came across so well in Mr. Dolby's presentation. The exploration of the two options offering different perspectives has offered a timely opportunity to pursue this alternative way forward. It provides the design principles proposed by the papers group with aspects of the business model provided through the work progress of the Cheshire West and Chester Council, which we explored previously. This would enable the council to develop a co-designed, co-produced model that combines the strength of both options. An independent feasibility study, which is attached to the report, has been conducted, and the study concludes that the proposed local authority trading company is the recommended delivery model and can achieve both the efficiency savings required and provide a sustainable quality service with potential for growth. The LATC will be developed and co-designed by a project team consisting of officers, carers, representatives, one from each centre, so that each centre has an input, staff representatives, independent business and legal advisors. And Cabinet will receive a further progress report in June 2014 that will include the full project plan and implementation timeline. So you can see that this is really moving on quite quickly. So I've come to Cabinet tonight to ask you to agree to the development of a Wirral not-for-profit local authority trading company, to agree for officers to progress the development of the co-design project group with the key stakeholders previously mentioned, agree to receive a further progress report in June, and to acknowledge the work undertaken to date that has enabled us to take this work forward. Thank you, Chair.
Okay, thanks for that, Chris. Can I say, I mean, I'm really delighted that we've been able to come up with a proposal here which kind of takes the best of those two options that we looked at a few weeks ago. And I think this is exactly the kind of approach that I'd be hoping that we would do more generally when we look at the remodelling work that we talked about earlier on. And I think it's great that we are going to be working very closely with parent carers around this model. And I just wish it well, and I'm sure our officers will give it every support that is needed to make it a success. So I'm really looking forward to seeing how this develops, and good luck to everybody concerned, and particularly thanks to John and I know the parent carers who've done an enormous amount of work on this, and it's really very much appreciated.
May I just say that on behalf of them, it took a lot of courage for officers and yourself to make this decision, and we appreciate that. So obviously, all I will say is that you've got 100% support from us.
Fantastic. Thanks, John. Okay. So can we agree? Can we agree these recommendations, Kevin?
Agreed.
Okay. Brilliant. Thanks very much. Wonderful. So that then moves us on to item 17, which is fees for residential care and nursing homes response and consultation. Chris?
Thank you, Shane. Although this seems to be coming onto the agenda very frequently, this is very important, which refers to 2014-15 payment fees. And we've been playing catch up, but we're now at the point where we can actually move forward on a process where we will be determining the nursing payment fees on a year-to-year basis. This approach is based upon the efficient Wirral payroll model to determine and calculate a fair and reasonable weekly rate. Provider engagement has been proactive and builds upon previous experience to enable refinements to the different elements within the modelling and has been undertaken. We did receive 21 actual costs from different providers, and this information kept approximately 20% of the current market provision. This information provided the basis for further direct discussions with providers to enable refinements to our calculations to determine actual costs. And I have to that officers have really spent a lot of time talking to the providers. The inevitable challenge is the range and diversity of the current market. However, we have endeavoured to determine a comprehensive approach that aims to make due allowance for actual costs and market returns. The model is intended to calculate a fair and reasonable weekly rate for the four different categories, and the overall increases are £5 a week for residential, £14 for residential EMI, £3 for nursing, and £5 for nursing EMI. In addition to this, Wirral CCGs will pay a fixed nursing contribution, and the amount for 13-14 was £109.79, and we still await the determination of the amount for next year. We have endeavoured to reflect the Wirral market position statement, market transformations in relation to domiciliary care, intermediate care, inclusive of the VA enablement, further debt developments allied to extra care housing initiatives, and the demographic changes associated with old age, increased complexity and dementia. We recognise the important part played by the residential and nursing care home sector in responding appropriately to the increasing levels of complexity and severity of needs confronting people as they grow older. This is still set within a developing range of services that promote and maximise people's ability to remain at home for tailored support. The rate changes within this report relate to services predominantly for older people, and we were reporting Cabinet in June the application of the Wirral efficient care home model in relation to mental health and learning disabilities. We recognise the coming together of a number of providers with legal representation who continue to raise questions, and we did meet them at the last meeting we had around this subject, but these have been responded to in a positive and meaningful manner. The Council remains committed to the maintenance of a quality service, and we are working through our quality assurance officers to establish a positive rapport and approach with the sector. The Cabinet report further references our comparative position across the North West, which demonstrates that we are reflective of a mid-market point. Equally, Wirral is now further ahead of other North West local authorities in seeking to set the fees for 2014-15, reflecting a positive and robust approach to providing engagements and Cabinet reporting. Finally, the collaborative working with CCG colleagues will affect a coordinated position in relation to the nursing element of care home provisions. So I'm asking you to agree the recommendations, which are that Cabinet are recommended to note the contents of the report and the proposed fee levels for 2014-15. To note that officers will give consideration to the ongoing nature of the year-on-year fee setting and the need for continued provider engagement so that we maintain focus in relation to this important aspect of service provision. And as indicated, we will report the outcome of engagement with mental health and learning disability care providers to June 2014.
Thanks, Chris. And I just want to recognise the huge amount of work that's gone into this piece, this report, and thank particularly our officers who've led on this. I think, as you say, Chris, if you look at the graphs at the back of this report, the appendix, we are at the mid-range compared to other authorities. We're, you know, we're not out of kilter. I think, given the funding context that you mentioned, I think this is a really good piece of work. So happy to support recommendations that you've outlined, and ask Cabinet to agree that. Okay, thank you. Right, item 18, health and social care integration, the Better Care Fund 2014 submission.
Thank you, Chair. This is a shorter one. This report brings the Cabinet an update relating to Wirral's submission for the Better Care Fund, which is put together on behalf of Wirral Council and Wirral Clinical Commissioning Group. The draft submission was signed off by the Health and Wellbeing Board, which has a key role in monitoring and influencing the integration of health and social care. The final submission must be made by the 4th of April. The 2-year plan will show how resources are to be used to improve local services. 2015, part of the pool fund will be held subject to performance-related improvement. The dashboard attached to the report shows what key areas of activity are proposed for monitoring, alongside the nationally prescribed indicators. And Cabinet have been asked to agree. They've been asked to note the draft submission and to recognise the role of the Health and Wellbeing Board in signing off the final submission, and to note the performance baseline and dashboard along with monitoring requirements. And can I say, Chair, that Jackie Evans in particular has put her heart and soul into this with saving from work, and I would like to thank people concerned who do all the hard work.
Yeah, I'll echo that. Those thanks. I know those two individuals in particular have done a huge amount on this. And clearly, you know, this is an important agenda to try and bring about more integration between NHS and our social care. And I think this is a really good plan which will help us build on the work that we have actually been doing in Wirral for some time now. So happy to echo your. Comments on that, and Cabinet to agree the recommendations on this report? Okay, thank you. Item 19. Now, is Cherry here? She's not. Cherry, the Council proposal was supposed to be here to introduce the recommendations from the Francis report, but sadly she's not, so that's a shame. So I'm simply going to say that I think this is obviously a hugely important piece of work. The Francis report was a real wake-up call, I think, for you know, the quality of care and a whole range of settings. And I think, again, like the previous report and what you talked to, I think this is a really good piece of scrutiny work. So I congratulate the members concerned. Who led this work, and it's great. You can see the recommendations that are included in the extract from the minutes of the report. I would simply invite Cabinet to agree those recommendations, and I think we're going to get further updates because I know that the scrutiny panel wanted to kind of review these issues on a regular basis. So can we as a Cabinet agree recommendations from that piece of scrutiny work?
Agreed.
Okay, thank you. Right, that takes us on to the highways and transportation items. So item 20 is the local transport capital funding and the integrated transport block programme 2014-15. Harry.
Thank you, Bill. Captain Tyler asked to consider in more detail the local transport capital programme 2014-15, as you said, and the integrated transport block ITB allocation. The report considers the ITB allocation of £1,653,000 awarded to Wirral Council from the Merseyside Local Transport Plan Settlement of 2014-15. The report considers the distribution of the ITB fund across four blocks. One, improving road safety, £638,000. Promoting active travel and health, £430,000. Thirdly, reducing congestion and carbon emission, £355,000. And lastly, transportation, general transportation, £230,000. From two of these blocks, improving road safety and active travel and health, £128,000 is proposed from each block to the constituency committees. So each constituency committee will get a share of that. This will provide each constituency committee with £64,000 from the 2014-2015 local transport allocation to allocate to road safety and active travel. In each constituency. In October 2013, Cabinet agreed a revised transportation capital programme which included slippage of £55,000 for constituency committees. Constituent committees will have an additional £13,750 each allocated to road safety and active travel schemes in 2014-15. I think it, well, just where that is, that these projects and schemes they drive growth, they reduce health inequalities, and of course, so as well as protecting vulnerable people, all three issues which are very close to our hearts, and I just think it's worth mentioning that. And so, in closing, cabinet are requested to approve the proposed allocation of 1,653,000 ITV funding to the four blocks and approve detailed programmes of schemes as set out in the report, sections 3 to 6 and appendix 8.
Thanks, Harry, and obviously, I'll echo your support for those proposals, those recommendations. But can I say I'm particularly pleased that we're allocating a large block of this to the constituency committees, because that's very much goes with the grain of our policy of trying to devolve more and more resources and responsibilities down to those committees. So I think that's really, really welcome. So happy to support you with those recommendations. So cabinet, right. And the third one, have they particularly mentioned that, or do I suppose? Okay, so with just to highlight recommendation little three, delegates, delegated authorities to head of service, environment regulation, in conjunction with cabinet members, street team, transport services, party spokespersons to make necessary adjustments to the priorities within the programme should the need arise due to financial conditions or other factors. Sure, it's happy. So, can we agree those recommendations?
Yeah.
Agree. Thank you. And that takes us on to item 21, Local Sustainable Transport Fund 2014-15 programme. Harry?
Okay, thank you, Phil. In 2011-12, 810,000 of the Local Sustainable Transport Fund, LSTF, money were awarded to Wirral as part of the Merseyside Transport Partnership funding application to the Department for Transport to assist residents to access employment opportunities, encourage the use of sustainable transport and reduce carbon emissions. In 2012-13, a further 3.2 million of LSTF funding was awarded to the Borough. Both allocations cover the time period 2011-12 to 2014-15. This funding is being used for a variety of capital and revenue projects as follows. 1. Travel solutions, 2. Business travel support, 3. Walking and cycling infrastructure, 4. Highway network improvements, and 5. Maxi taxi. The 2014-15 programme has been developed to continue these successful projects and aims to lower the barriers that people face when trying to access employment and training opportunities. Cabinet is requested to accept an additional 215,000 of funding, which is recently been secured for commercial travel, approve the delivery of the 2014-15 revenue and capital programmes, delegate authority to the head of environmental and regulation in conjunction with the cabinet member and party spokespersons to make any necessary adjustments to the priorities within the programme should the need arise. And the need arise could be that a utility may want to do work on a road we can't access it, so and it's a yearly event that. And also delegate authority to the head of environment and regulation in conjunction with the cabinet member and party spokesperson, accept any additional funding that may be made available for 2014-15 should this arise, and improve allocation across the programmes as appropriate. And finally, Phil, just before I sign off, I think the officers at Tech Services should be congratulated on securing the extra funding. There's £1 million that was surplus, and they gained 213,000 of that. And I think they should be congratulated because their application must have hit the button spot on. So I think they absolutely should be recorded that we thank the officers.
Okay.
Congratulations.
Yeah, okay. So, just to ask Cabinet, so the recommendations are set out in paragraph 14.1. Can we agree all those recommendations? Items 1 to 5, is that correct? Okay, thank you. Great, and finally, that takes us to item 22, which is the Neighbourhoods Programme Review. And George, can I ask you to introduce this, please?
Just introduce it with thanks, Phil. Well, over the past year, four districts have been established in
Glossy was Wirral, Wirral South, and then had, they're all at different levels, because